Phil, let me bring back my law enforcement panel. Phil, let me start with you. Cesar Sayoc, he also threatened you and your family on Twitter.
He did. Now, let me be coldly analytic here. The last hour was tough. I had to call my family and tell them this was going to break today, that this man threatened me with death on Twitter. I was not aware of that. You know, we are correct, and General Clapper is correct. Let me repeat it so we ensure that we understand what question we're asking you. The question is not whether the President of the United States is responsible for a disturbed human being who threatens an act of murder. That is not on the table. Of course the President is not. I'm an analyst, though, so instead of getting emotional, let me go cold. When 50,000, 100,000, 200,000 people go to rallies, when millions of people watch you on the screen, if you threaten people, some of those individuals, maybe 0.001%, are going to take you seriously. The question is whether the president takes risk off the table by stopping threats on social media. It's not whether we hold him responsible for the acts of a deranged person. Stop threatening people, because the implications are people like me have to call their family and say, thank God he's in prison, because otherwise maybe he shows up at my house.
Josh, what are the biggest clues as an investigator you would take away when looking at that van?
So, you know, we've talked about the commonality so far in the target set. Now we have these disturbing messages on social media. But the van itself, there's what we can see from the outside. Obviously, a lot of the messaging that we see there on the pictures, a lot of political paraphernalia on the side. You know, the CNN sucks. You know, again, it's painting this portrait of someone whose views appear at least in line with some of the invective that we've seen from the president and others going after our network, going after, you know, other politicians. So that seems to be in line. The question, Jake, is going to be what's inside, and that is if investigators actually find evidence that you know, the bombs were either transported or perhaps assembled in that vehicle. There's some question as far as whether the subject actually lived inside the vehicle. One question I had is we see the SWAT officers there transporting it. I find it difficult to believe that they would quickly transport a vehicle that contained evidence of explosives in it. So again, there's a lot we don't know that will be processed, but there's a looming question as far as where the devices were actually assembled, and then where the mailing was actually done. And then the last question, Jake, which may come from an interview with the subject and may come from other evidence, is are there other devices out there? And there'll be a number of ways investigators will be able to determine that. But until that final determination is made, they're not going to give the all clear.
And I was wondering that, too. And Evie, let me ask you, how concerned would law enforcement be that not only there could be explosive material in the van, but the van could be rigged with explosives?
I would think that before they decided to transport the van, that they would check the van and make sure that there's nothing in there that could detonate. Like, that's just standard protocol. You're going to make sure that before you move anything, or even before you enter a house or a residence, you're going to make sure everything is rendered safe, that there's nothing there that could go off. And so I'm pretty sure that they followed that protocol before they decided to transport the van.
You're probably right. Phil, what do you think law enforcement is doing right now to determine how long this has been planned, his operational capability, whether others are involved?
Well, we had the first indication that he was speaking initially. Those questions aren't about what happened. I'm guessing those questions are about imminent threat. Are there other bombs out there? Are there people who participated in this with you? We heard that he lawyered up, and so I presume he's not speaking anymore. But as soon as they gain access to that van, we had a report on a cell phone, his cell phone pinging, which helped them identify his location. I want to know every contact on that list. I want to know text messaging records. I want to talk to his family. I want to look at his social media posts, not only to look at who he communicated with, Jake, but to see if he participated in a community of people that not only might have encouraged him, but that might be encouraging other people. You can build, in short, a network of understanding around someone's life using that digital profile really quickly.
Josh, a lawyer who represented Sayoc told CNN that he wasn't surprised that the devices is suspected and accused of assembling and mailing did not explode. He questioned his former client's ability to successfully devise and execute such a scheme. Obviously, Sayoc initially told law enforcement that they were never intended to go off. Does it matter whether these devices were capable of detonating?
It doesn't in the long run, because it's still terrorism. Now, a lot of people, you know, we've heard folks trying to analyze this over the last 72 hours, and there seemed to be a narrative, well, he either has to be a master bomb maker or he has to be a complete dolt. I would argue there's somewhere in between is also possible. He could be someone who, you know, at least researches and has a level of sophistication, but perhaps doesn't take it all the way to creating a device that's going to explode and kill. But the reason I say it doesn't matter in the long run here, and obviously we're grateful that there were no injuries or loss of life, but this is still terrorism. His goal appears to have been to instill fear, to, you know, cause anxiety for political reasons. That is terrorism. So whether they went off or not, he's still facing potential serious charges in the long run, Jake.
So we've been digging into the suspect's social media accounts, which are, as you know, filled with political attacks, many directed at those he eventually allegedly targeted with these devices. I want to focus on just a couple. One of them is a reply to President Trump. President Trump criticizing the media and on August 30th, and President Trump tweeted, I just cannot state strongly enough how totally dishonest much of the media is. Truth doesn't matter to them. They only have their hatred and agenda. This includes fake books, which come out about me all the time, always anonymous sources, and are pure fiction. Enemy of the people. Now, to that, the suspect, Cesar Sayoc, replied directly to that tweet from the president saying CNN sucks, holding up a posted photograph of him holding up a sign that said CNN sucks. In another tweet, the suspect replied to a CNN tweet. The CNN tweet shows CNN's chief White House correspondent Jim Acosta in the briefing room asking Sarah Sanders, please say that the press isn't the enemy of the American people. And Sayoc he replies to that tweet and he seems to threaten Acosta, our own White House correspondent, writing, quote, see you at the next rally. Evie, let me ask you, I mean, I'm not a law enforcement official, and obviously, as has been said by plenty of other people, the bomber is responsible for his actions. No one else is responsible for his actions. But that really does seem like somebody who really wants to take cues from the president, wants the president's approval, and that, I assume, is something that people are considering when they're trying to figure out motive.
So, you know, we've been talking about this, and I've been with the various presidents, both former and current President Barack Obama, and when you go to these rallies, and there's sometimes tens of thousands of people, and people get revved up. I mean, this is a very influential position, a person, and when somebody like that, of that level, speaks, sometimes people take that and they listen to it, like they take it to heart, and you can see people getting obsessed with the individual. And that's where, you know, as an agent, we would get individuals who would show up to the White House, write these letters. I mean, this is something very common for us in our line of work because people almost think like, yes, he's speaking to me. He's addressing me. And so, you know, yes, your words do matter. You do affect other individuals in the way you speak. And it's something that you have to be very careful with when you are on that level. And then also, Jake, you also don't know how everybody's going to receive that message. We have individuals with a lot of mental health issues who can hear that message. And we don't know the current state of the suspect that we have. We don't know his mental health. We do know he has a criminal record. But then there's concern there because we see this. There's nothing really. He wasn't very quiet about what he did. You see his van, it's very ostentatious with all these stickers out there, his previous history, his threats about making a bomb. So it'd be really, really interesting to find out what his mental health stance is, what he's done in the past, and what the people around him interviews will be really, really important. Even though he may not be talking, interviewing family, friends, previous coworkers, anybody like that, to get as much information on him as possible.
Hey, Jake, can I just quickly add a caveat, just very quickly, to what you were saying as far as the bomber is responsible solely for his actions? Let me add one caveat there, if I can. That is, we should hold elected leaders to a different standard. If you look at this as any other type of crime, you don't just go after the crime itself, you go after the underlying cause. And if that is an elected official spewing invective, then that they bear some responsibility.